On behalf of Sri Chandra Prabhu Jain family, I am Ms. K. Mugil, Head Department of English, pleased to welcome you all for the national webinar on Ecofeminism and in Indian English Poetry. I extend my warm greetings to our Secretary, Sri Lalit Kumar Ojain, Advisor Dr. D. Amachan, Principal Dr. V. Nakajoti, Vice Principal Dr. N. Sujata for their awe and support in ensuring the success of this national webinar. I accord a genial welcome to a resource person, an eminent personality, Dr. Nandini Sago, Director, School of Foreign Languages, Professor of English, School of Humanities at Indira Gandhi National Open University, New Delhi. Ma'am, we feel honored for accepting our invitation and grateful for your presence on this special day. I extend a wholehearted welcome to the academicians and students from the diverse places across the nation. I'm sure that this webinar will be much meaningful to all the participants. Have a good day. Thank you. I request our principal to present the inaugural address.
Thank you very much, Mugil ma'am.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Good morning. Very good morning to one and all. First of all, let me express my sincere thanks to Dr. Nandini Saku for accepting our invitation and going to address the national seminar on ecofeminism. And before we go ahead, let me express my view on about the ecofeminism. Then I'll hand over the session to our guest speaker of the day. Ecofeminist awareness emerged in the third world, where environmental problems like droughts, floods, cyclones, deforestation, and so on affect people, especially women, earlier and more intensely. In India, for example, in the early 1970s, a group of women formed a movement, the Sipo movement, to save their forests from exploitation for industrial and commercial purposes. These forests had been monopolized by British colonial rule, and after independence, remained state property with a strong military influence. For the villagers, adjoined these forests on the slopes of the Himalayas, inhabited mainly by women. Men migrated to work in the city. Forests were very important, especially the fight against erosion. It was therefore in the name of the preservation of their environment that these Indian peasants began to encircle the trees to prevent their being cut down and basically interposing themselves between them and the army that came to cut them. The action was successful because the military did not dare to attack women. A leading Indian philosopher, Vandana Shiva, who joined the movement, has played an important role in shaping the eco-feminist vision. She opposes the birth control policies that led, with the help of the Indian army, to the abortion of fetuses of girls, less valued in India than boys, especially because of the dowry to be paid by the families of girls at weddings. In Latin American countries, ecofeminism is mainly related to the concept of human behavior contributed by indigenous people. This way of thinking, in which women play an important role, is based on a harmonious relationship between nature and human beings. It favors the quality of life rather than the acquisition of a quantity of objects. The emergence of ecofeminism in the United States and Europe dates back to the early 1980s in a very different context. And as far as the ecofeminism is concerned, India is setting a very good example, because if you take, you know, in Rajasthan, there is a village. In that village, whenever a baby girl is born, they are planting 111 trees. So they also take care of the trees till as long as she grows. And they are keeping aloe vera plants neighboring to that 111 trees. And this aloe vera is feeding these people. So as far as ecofeminism is concerned, I firmly believe that it is women who are capable of taking care of this environment, and they are protecting. They are not only protecting our family, they are also protecting us, all of us, and they are also protecting this, the environment. So with these few words, I will hand over this session to our ma'am, Dr. Nandini Sahu, the eminent personality from Indira Gandhi National Open University, who is going to give a very good a speech on this stage. So I hand over this session to ma'am. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Let me introduce the chief guest of the day. It matters not what someone is born, but what they grow to be. Our resource person, Professor Nandini Sahu, has rightly proved this course in her profession. She is the director, School of Foreign Languages and Professor of English at Indira Gandhi National Open University, New Delhi. She is recognized as a major voice in contemporary Indian English literature and has accomplished a doctorate in Indian English literature under the guidance of late Professor Niranjan Mohanty, Professor of English, Vishwabharti Shantiniketan. Professor Nandini Sahu is a triple gold medalist in English literature who has a rich professional experience, can see her as a poet and creative writer of international repute. Her significant works has been widely published in India, USA, UK, Africa, and Pakistan. Apart from numerous... literary awards, she has received the gold medal in the year 2019. She is the author and editor of 13 books, namely The Other Voice, The Postcolonial Space, Writing the Self and the Nation, Folklore, On the Alternative Modernities, Dynamics of Children's Literature, and Zero Point. Her poetry collections are The Silence, The Silver Poems on My Lips, Sukama and Other Poems, Swarnareka and Sita. Her areas of research interest cover Indian literature, new literatures, folklore and culture studies, American literature, children's literature, and critical theory. She is the chief editor, founder editor of Interdisciplinary Journal of Literature and Language, a biannual peer-reviewed journal in English. Professor Nandini Sahu, a distinct personality, has designed academic programs, courses on folklore and culture studies, children's literature, and American literature for IGNO. Ma'am, we are fortunate to have your presence on this special day and looking forward to an enlightening session. May I request Professor Nandini Sahu to present the keynote address. Over to you, ma'am.
Hello, good morning, everyone. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you're audible.
Yes, there is no problem with the voice quality. Half of your voice I could not hear. There was some echo and I think people were writing also that it is echoing. So please check the voice quality.
Let me check it now, ma'am.
Yeah. Good morning, everyone. So first of all, I would thank Sri Chandrababa Jain College for having invited me for this very important lecture on ecofeminism, one of the most important upcoming areas of research and pedagogy. Dr. Nagajyoti, Principal Sir, thank you very much. And Dr. Mughal, thank you very much for taking all the pain all these days. You have been in touch with me, talking to me constantly. With all that humility and politeness. So thank you very much for being such an enthusiast for literature and language and of course for research in ecofeminism, all of you. Today I will be talking about ecofeminism in Indian English poetry. See, there are so many poets who are writing actually from an ecofeministic perspective, and it will be difficult, in fact impossible for me to take all those poets and discuss all of them. So I would be choosing a few Indian women poets from three generations, from the generation. I understand that here I am today in the capacity of being a creative writer, being a poet. When I talk about my generation and ecofeminism in Indian English poetry, I would be taking a few lines from some of my contemporary poets and also some of my poems. About my association with muses, with poetry, I started writing at a very early age. When I was hardly 7 years old, I was just a kid, 7 years old, and I started writing poetry, and my first poem was about ecology. I saw that the farmers, the people, the farmers were working in the fields when it was heavily raining, when we were cozily, comfortably taking rest at home. I saw the farmers were working. And then I came home and I wrote a small poem for them, thanking the farmers. So my first ever poem, today I have 14 books published, but my first ever poem was about ecology, about the farmers and their contribution to our lives. And then I kept on writing in my language is English, of course. I have been writing poetry only in English. Though I read a few other languages, my mother tongue is Odia, and I read Hindi and some other languages, but I write in English. So my first poetry collection was published in 2004 when I was in Odisha. I was in a technical university in Odisha. I wrote my first poetry book, The Other Voice. And that poetry collection has a lot of poems. Even today, when I look back, I go through those poems. I cherish the memories of my association with humanity, with nature, with ecology. And most of the poems in that collection also are purely ecological. And then the next collection was published in 2005, The Silence. And in that poem also, my relationships with the human beings, with the world around me, I had taken. And that is also, I would say, a collection of poems related to the ecology, the environment, and humanity. And then I came to Delhi in 2006 as a reader in English, and then my next poetry collection was published in Delhi in 2009, Silver Poems in My Lips. So that collection has a lot of poems which are closely associated with my understanding of human behavior, my understanding of nature, and being more accepting, more universal, being more accessible and more accepting of whatever life has to offer us. And the next book was Sukama and Other Poems, my poetry collection. So Sukama is a woman. In whose poetry, private woman, and she was working at our place as the domestic help, and from her collection, from that collection, you can find a lot of poems which are related to tribal literature.
Sound nahi hai. Sound. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, we can hear you.
Okay, but I cannot hear you all.
Hello?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Is it audible?
Yes, okay, ma'am, it's audible.
Yeah, you know what happened? Some technical glitch was there, so I was disconnected.
Okay, fine.
Okay, fine. So the next poetry collection that I was telling you, Sukama and Other Poems, that was published, and I will come to that. And the other next two collections are Sita, and then there is an edited volume, Suvarnarekha, and then Zero Point was my most recent collection. And last week, my selected poems got published, Selected Poems of Nandini Sahu. So this is my contribution to Indian English poetry. With that, let me come to ecofeminism in Indian English poetry.
I'm sorry to interrupt you. We couldn't able to see you. Video is not visible.
You're able to hear me, right?
Yes. I could able to hear you.
Okay, fine. So let me continue like this. Then I will get back to the video. Some technical issues are there. I'm not getting connected.
Sure. Okay, ma'am. You can carry on.
Okay. So I would request the researchers to listen to me carefully. And if they have a pen and paper, please take down the important points. We will have a discussion on ecofeminism as a critical theory. Ecofeminism is one of the most important critical theories, and it's an area of research and pedagogy today. Most of the universities, including IGNO, including some very important universities in the world, they are introducing academic programs on ecofeminism. Ecofeminism is a very broad term. It has something to do with witness literature. You know, in the court of law, the role of a witness is very important. He can actually twist and turn the complete case. Similarly, in case of social change, for the change of the society, for the revision, for the upliftment, upgradation of the society, the role of the writers, creative writers, is very, very important. And that kind of literature is called witness literature. So ecofeminism is somehow connected to witness literature. Eco-feminist issues are like the issues of water preservation, livestock, challenging the culture of thrift, saving, preservation, conservation, archiving, documentation, and it also challenges the culture of waste, wasting anything, environment pollution, it challenges capitalism, colonialism, climate change, it supports the girl child, education, and food for all, the senior citizens. It talks about folklore and culture studies. Ecofeminism believes in acceptance of all. It talks about subaltern issues, folklore issues, masculinity studies, gender studies, mental health issues. So many things come under ecofeminism, and this is the need of the hour. During COVID-19, when the world is struggling with an epidemic, a pandemic, and when everyone is struggling for survival, and during this kind of a period, you know, during this period, ecofeminism is the need, and we need to talk about the issues related to ecology. People keep asking me, ma'am, what is the difference between feminism and ecofeminism? Well, you know, there is not much of difference between feminism and ecofeminism, just a thin line. Any writer, if you ask me to describe it in a very simplistic term, not just simple, but simplistic term, I would say that any writer, be it male or female writer, or a writer from the third gender, having ecological consciousness in his or her writing would be called an ecofeministic writer. And what is ecological consciousness? I already told you that ecofeminism covers so many issues which your principal, Dr. Nagajyoti, just pointed out. I would only repeat that ecofeminism covers important issues like preservation and conservation and livestock. It challenges all negativities. It talks about archiving and documentation. It talks about environment, the preservation of the environment. It challenges capitalism, colonialism, climate change. It talks about the support of the girl child and the education and food for everyone. And folklore and culture studies, these kind of subjects which have been treated as subjects of subaltern literature, they are a part of ecofeminism today. And it believes in acceptance of everybody. It talks about the senior citizens, the subaltern issues, masculinity studies also. I'll come to masculinity studies. And then it also talks about mental health issues. You see, today so many youngsters are committing suicide. They are not able to handle the issues of loneliness, isolation, quarantine, and many people are committing suicide. They are going through depression. So ecofeminism also talks about mental health issues. So basically, to cut a long story short, ecofeminism talks about reading literature through cultural materialism. In most of my lectures, I point it out to the researchers that you should read cultural materialism as a part of your critical theory. So the points that I just hinted at, they are a part of your cultural materialism. We will come to each one of those points during the course of my lecture. Ecofeminism is a term coined by a French writer, Francois de Yuburne, in the year 1974. So this is not really very old. It's a very recent term in the late 20th century movement. It was a response to the increasingly global damage affected by advanced capitalist societies. The capitalist societies were damaging the society, you know. So ecofeminism came as a protest to that. So it's a part of our protest literature also. Ecofeminism is a part of your protest literature also. So you can also take down this point. We'll have a discussion. A leading inspiration in this ecofeministic movement was a demonstration by women at the Greenham Common in the 1970s against stationing of cruise missiles in the UK. So it was one of the basic ideas that nothing can be preserved or nothing can be, you know, the missiles cannot be kept at one place like this. So ecofeminists, they came forward to oppose, to protest against that. And some other groups also, they talked about ecofeminism, like the Greenpeace, formed in the year 1971, the Green Party in Germany in the year 1980, and then another movement was Gaia, G-A-I-A, Great Mother Earth Movement. It was an animal liberation movement in 1971. So you see, preservation of the natural resources, that includes animals, Gaia, the movement, it was also a part of the ecological movement. And ecofeminism entered India with that Chipku movement, with the Chipku movement about which we will talk. A group of women activists, they hugged the trees in order to stop people from cutting the trees. So Chipku movement was the introduction to ecofeministic movement in India. So basically this entire tradition, it seeks to master nature in the interests of increased growth, expanded markets and profit. So basically ecofeminism is close to nature as essentialism, and it is a nostalgic assumption of a pre-cultural origin in nature. So nature and culture taken together, that is what ecofeminism tries to propagate, tries to talk in favor of. Okay, then one change that has taken place in the world of cultural interventions last few years is that of writing. Most people are writing now. The group that is listening to me now, I'm sure most of you are writers. Some of you write research papers, you write stories, you write poetry. So the cultural intervention today is that of writing and staging and teaching literature. And today women have outnumbered men when it comes to writing, teaching and research and staging literature. I will give you one example. Right after the civil rights movement in the late 1960s, men had started discarding the world of literature. They thought the world of literature is unproductive, and then they moved mostly to science technology. During this kind of a period, with the advent of feminism, feminism was coming in a big way at that time during the civil rights movement. And then more and more women, they entered the deserted area of creative writing. And they tried to convert that area of creative writing into a lush green field. This is just one simple example that how the female genetic code promotes better survival strategy. Women are better survivors than the other genders. I'll give you a very simple example. I was just going through the other day, I think Dev Rishra is going through some newspaper where among the COVID-19 patients and the death rates, the ratio is 65-35 between men and women. I don't know how far it is correct, but it was based on a questionnaire taken by a group of youngsters. They did a pilot study where they found that the ratio is 65-35 men-women in the COVID-19 patients and death rates. See, so in this extreme situation also, women know how to survive. And not only they do survive, they know how to laugh against the odds, and they talk in a language that is distinctly their own. And that language I call is the ecofeministic language, and that literature, if the right literature, that is ecofeministic literature. Some people voice their sattvic acrosh, which is called the pious rage, anger, against the discriminatory structures of all kinds. Women activists, writers, journalists, artists, they talk about such kind of things in an urgency of a telegram. Younger generation, you do not know telegrams, but when we were small children, telegrams were so important in our lives. You know, the telegrams are over, but this idiomatic vigor and the emotive phrase is still there. So when you talk about telegraphic urgency, you mean that something very pressing, something very important, something most urgent. So women have this urgency in their writing. Ecofeministic writers, they have this kind of urgency in their writing. They want to write most urgently. They cannot do without writing. Creative writing is therapeutic for them. I have gone through the lives of so many women writers, mostly women writers, I would say. who have written in their interviews that I was suicidal, but when I started writing, when I became a poet or a creative writer, that suicidal tendency was gone from me. So writing worked as a therapy for me. So eco-feministic writers, they believe in writing, creative writing as therapy. Creative writing that cleans you from inside, that makes you more forgiving, more accepting of the things that life has to offer you. It is through this dialectical oscillation between the symbolic and the semiotic that I have been talking about, that the forceful women writers and thinkers, they give birth to words. I would give you one example from Luz Irigaray. She is a Belgian French feminist writer, philosopher. She is a linguist and psycholinguist and psychoanalyst. Luz Irigaray, you can Google her. And she is also a cultural theorist. She examined the uses and misuses of language in relation to women. Her first and most well-known book was published in 1974. The name of the book was Spectrum of the Other Women. It analyzes the texts of Freud, Hegel, Plato, Aristotle, and Lacan, and Kant through the lens of phallocentrism. You all know about phallocentrism, that in some of the critical texts, women have been accused of being the inferior sex due to the absence of phallus in them. She problematizes that. In one of her books, The Sex Which Is Not One, she writes about the term father tongue. We talk about mother tongue, she talks about father tongue. So I was just trying to understand what exactly she means by father tongue. She talks about the language of power, which declines to accept women as a part of it. So phallocentric language excludes women. So this kind of language she calls father tongue. And she raises very important questions about the agency and leaves people wondering how women can be a part of this great, beautiful world without being loyal to the compulsions of their bodily rhythms. So women sometimes speak through their body. That's what she tries to tell. So with semiotic sensations, with contractual labor and the feeding of the children. So, you know, these things that are closely related to childbirth, grooming, and breeding of the humanity, that women talk, women use a language. So the language that excludes women and their concerns is basically named as father tongue by the critic Luz Irigaray. So when I was going through her, I thought this is very important when we discuss about eco-feminism today. Basically because of the brilliant flash of an extraordinary, masterfully vibrant language that women all over the world are coming up, that eco-feminism is taking a new shape today through fiction, poetry, creative and critical reflections, through literature, cinema, education, through reservations, through love, liberty, motherhood, through health, war, opposing war, everything that comes under ecofeminism as a part of its, you know, area of research. You know, in the developing world, even today, especially in the developing world, women's writing is considered rather like a luxury by some critics. I'll come to those critics one by one. And they consider women's writing as a hydra-headed activity of busy for nothing, overtly ambitious, leaky crackpots. I'm quoting. So they consider women's writing like that. And even some of them have written that women waste their time in blackening the pages when they should be actually submerged in cheering of their men. And ecofeminism is a voice against this. You know, not that women in these developing countries are insensitive to the sufferings and humiliations of deserving men. Because, you know, if you come to masculinity studies, you will find a lot of researchers are women, and I am one of them. I do a lot of research activities and creative writing on masculinity studies. I also talk about the challenges of men. My new book that is coming, it's a poetry book. The title of the book is Karna. I have taken the character Karna from Mahabharata. And I have placed him vis-a-vis contemporary men, their challenges they face, and sometimes the injustice some men have to go through. So not that women do not understand the sensitive issues of sufferings of men. Sometimes men are unemployed, underemployed, fathers, brothers, lovers, husbands and sons and partners, and women write about them. The term Purusharta was written in the Veda by a woman sage. She has written Purusharta, the manly duties like dharma, earth, kaam and moksha. These are the four duties of a man to fulfill as Purusharta. And she has written very empathetically about the Purusharthas and then the fulfilling of those duties, what kind of challenges men go through. Even today, we contemporary women writers and critics, we talk about at least two of those Purusharthas, earth and kaam, money and lust. Those two which have solid material base, and when men get trapped into these two, we write with a lot of empathy for them, not just sympathy. So men have to understand this, that women understand this agony, and they write about it. And when they write about it, it's not about not to humiliate the men, but to create a ripple of change. Because people who are written about, they gain the focus. They gain an intense empathy. And empathy does make a lot of difference. When we talk about the men and their challenges, you create that ripple of change in the first place. And a lot of women writers, ecofeministic writers, they also write about these empathetic issues related to men. So in order to discuss that, well, women, even in our ecofeministic writings, sometimes we find sentences like modesty or lajja. It supports to be stri dhan. So it's not just stri dhan. Modesty should be distributed equally among the three genders. Because be it the fund of virtues, resources, opportunities, anything, monopoly is a bad idea. So it should be distributed equally among all. So equal distribution is also a part of our eco-feministic concern. And both male and female, as well as the writers from the third gender, they are talking about equal distribution vis-a-vis eco-feminism. I'll give an example from Harivansh Purana when I talk about these philosophical inquiries of equal distribution. It has an eco-feministic interpretation. At least I did an eco-feministic interpretation of this Harivansh Purana story. It begins with an epical depiction of the burned remains of the deserted battlefield of the Mahabharata. After 18 days of drama, ultimately the battlefield is... the war comes to a close, and a sage with his bunch of disciples is passing by. And then suddenly he notices that a huge bell is fallen in the neck of, in the middle of the field. Perhaps it has come down, it has come from the neck of an elephant. Elephants, they wear bell in the battlefield. But there is something very strange about that bell. It is fallen on the ground, but it is producing a sweet tinkling noise. The sage asks his disciples to check, what is this sweet noise coming from the bell? And very soon they discover that there are four little birds, chidiya, four little birds fluttering their wings inside the huge bell. The sage closes his eyes and he explains how traces of life start playing in the middle of death and disaster because of the simultaneity of life. Now, we can choose to read this episode as a metaphor for the basic principles of creation vis-a-vis ecofeminism. Truth may be one, but it can materialize through different binaries, different interpretations. As an ecofeminist, I read this as, the four bells or the four birds, they represent the thirst for survival, the thirst for love, the thirst for knowledge, and then the thirst for peace. Survival, love, knowledge, and peace. So this is how we can interpret the stories from our ancient knowledge system, and then we can apply those to our contemporary life and literature. Like the soft tinkle voice noise produced by the little wings of the birds, peace talks softly. The language of peace is very soft, very euphonic, but still you can hear it because it's a distinct voice. The soldiers of peace, artists, writers all over the world, they never lose heart. They produce eco-feministic literature. The Greco-Arabic concepts of salam, shairan, and shalom. Salam, you must have heard your friends saying you salam. These words also pick up ideas of peace found in concepts like justice, equality, and freedom. That means, you know, shalom or salam, it means justice, equality, and freedom, like shanti. The word shanti also means giving personal space and equality, justice, and freedom to people around you. So, you know, from the discussion that I have been doing now, I would come to these two points that you should abstain from hurting fellow human beings and disrupting the rhythms of the biosphere, the atmosphere, animals and plants. So these are the two best virtues prescribed by ecofeminism. Ecofeminism addresses the Occidental and the Oriental concepts, the Western and the Eastern concepts, the two fundamental illusions. The illusion of the East is that with the right human beings and the right interpersonal relations, the universe will take care of itself. Like, you know, we Orientals, Eastern people, we believe through our folklore, myth, and our basic training and our language and literature and our social concepts, we believe that when everything is right with human lives, with right interpersonal relationships, the universe takes care of itself, regardless of all the wrongs and violence around us. We believe that. And the illusion of the Western peace theory. See, there is a difference. Eastern peace theory is all is right with the world. Universe will take care of itself. Sometimes you might have heard that people tell you, jo bhi hota hai, acche ke liye hota hai. We believe that everything happens for good. So this is Eastern peace theory. And Western peace theory, Occidental peace theory, what says that once we get the structures right, we can put any kind of humans into it without addressing their unresolved and interpersonal conflicts and their lack of interpersonal competence. So they feel, they believe in construction and deconstruction. They believe once the structures are right, we can put any kind of human beings into it without addressing their unsolved interpersonal conflicts. And you know what ecofeminism does? It attempts a balance between these two. Ecofeminism is a balance between the Oriental and the Occidental concepts of peace. That even if human beings know how to take care of themselves, even if there is a very good interpersonal relationship, but still if there is violence, there is wrong in the structure, then we should not accept it. And ecofeminism also challenges the Western theory that if everything has a good structure, the structure is right, even then human beings should be put into it. There should be a human touch. There is science, there is technology to support us, but if there is no human touch, then probably the world will never come to a completion. So ecofeminism believes in combining both of them. Okay, so ecofeminism, it discourages the ideas of hyperfemininity. By hyperfemininity, you can jot down this term, we will talk about it later again. By hyperfemininity, what I mean, that sometimes we reduce women either to a dumb cheer girl, beautiful person only, like a Cinderella who is waiting for her lover to come for her, or like a Barbie doll, or sometimes like an intelligent manipulator, somebody who is there doing some sort of kitchen politics and breaking houses. We do not want eco-feminists. We do not want these kind of hyper-femininity. We talk in favor of the real women. And then eco-feminists do not want a hyper-masculinity. Now, what is hyper-masculinity? It makes men aggressive, bossy, and crude. So men don't cry. These kind of ideas are challenged. Why men should not cry? Boys can always cry. A boy can always shed tears if there is something heartrending for him. So ecofeminism wants to remember that samrasya. Samrasya means harmony. Samrasya or harmony is the guiding principle of both aesthetics and ethics. If we want to be aesthetically and ethically perfect, and we want to be ecofeministic, then we have to create a balance between the two. Anything that is ethically frustrating, like violence, should be checked. Getting excessive of anything seems to be the root cause of human peril today. Just imagine COVID-19, Corona is a challenge from the planet Earth, from nature to us. For years and years, we human beings, we started behaving like the masters of the universe. Now, COVID-19 came to tell us that you are not masters of the universe, but you are just a part of it. You are equal to all other living beings. You are equal to animals and plants and everything else, the flora and the fauna. So this is what ecofeminism says. Getting excessive of anything is bad. We human beings were trying to get excess of all the benefits the planet has to distribute. We never believed in equal distribution. We tried to take the best of everything because we are talking animals. We can talk, we can speak. Other animals can think, but they do not use, they do not speak the language that we speak. So we thought that they are not speaking to us. And we tried to get excess of it. And then we destroyed the ecological balance. And then COVID-19 kind of a disease came, and it has put all of us inside our homes. And today we are brooding over it. So ecofeminism is arguably, it's a global commitment. It's a global commitment to make you understand the unity of nature and science. You, as a researcher of ecofeminism, should understand the unity of nature and science. And it is a commitment to make good and feel better. Like Raymond Williams has said, ecological proposals are invariably proposals about the different kinds of society. By different kinds of society, what I understand is he means the society, all the societies in the ecology, human society, and also the society of the animals, the plants. So this means we occupy a wide spectrum of political positions, and we have a perspective looking to an ideal past and a transformed future society as ecofeministic writers. This ecological movement, it has been shaping distinctly contemporary agendas since 1990s. Though it started in the 1960s and then it took so many publications in 1970s, as I have already mentioned about all of them to you. In 1990s, it came up in a very big way, talking about acid rain, pollution, pesticides in the food chain, extinction of the species, and then ruin of the old, historical places and the valuables. And above all, ecofeminism talked about global warming also. As a result, the social thinkers, philosophers, botanists, and literary personalities, people like you and me, the literary personalities, they started talking about ecofeminism in a more integral and a more complex way. When you talk about third world feminism, the relevance of academic feminism in the third world feminism in the 1980s and 90s, during the postmodernism and post-colonialism, it has raised more questions about women's relation to technologies and the changed conditions. Post-feminist authors, they looked at lesbian studies and queer studies. Now, ecofeminism has also taken queer theory or LGBTQ, lesbian, queer, bisexual, transgender studies also into its fold as a sense of fragmentation. And now queer studies is coming up as a very important area of research, and universities are designing academic programs on those. The other day, I read a slogan somewhere, the personal is political, vis-a-vis ecofeminism. So when you talk about your personal issues, you are actually talking about the society. And when you are talking about the political issues of the society, they directly affect you. So the personal is political and vice versa, the other way around also. And ecofeminism initiates this kind of an inquiry. The personal is political. So basically, ecofeminism has a purely interdisciplinary approach. This is coming up as an academic discipline, and it is an interdisciplinary approach. Your university, your college is holding this very important seminar today on ecofeminism because after a few years, say a couple of years, all other theories like your post-colonialism, post-modernism, gender studies, and everything will come under ecofeminism. I do not claim that only women are the patrons of ecofeminism. I do not find better feministic writers than Rabindranath Tagore or Premchand to say, or Sarachandra Chattopadhyay or Gabriel Garcia Marquez or Shakespeare. Such great men writers, male writers, have written books, novels, you know, critical books on ecofeministic issues. So all these theories that we are talking today will, in due course of time, come under ecofeminism. The poets today all over the world, from you know, the Anglo-American circle, African-American circle, French-American circle, and Indian writing in English, they are trying to focus and highlight the important theme, that is ecological observation. They inspire the human mass of the world that voices of women are never, or voices of ecofeminists are never regional, they are rather global. So after giving this kind of a detailed introduction on ecofeminism, now I will talk about some contemporary Indian women poets. Today you have invited me to talk about Indian women poets writing in English as an Indian woman poet myself. So there are many poets, you know most of them. There are many, I may not be able to name all of them. Kamala Das, Meena Alexander, Sujata Bhatt, Gauri Deshpande, Mamta Kalia, Eunice D'Souza, Imtiaz Dharkar, Tara Patel. And I will talk about some of them, and then slowly I will place myself in the historiography of these ecofeminist Indian poets. All these poets have a consensus of the ecological essentialism. They talk about the landscapes and the roots. They seem to be culturally rich at adopting a green agenda. I like this word, green agenda, and it is a commitment to a single issue. The single issue is planet Earth, and it is committed to higher gains. So the single issue is green agenda, planet Earth, and the higher gain is the benefit, the welfare. So you have poets in India, women poets in India who have been writing in English, like Kamala Das, Mamta Kalia, Melani Silgado, Eunice D'Souza, Imtiaz Dharkar, Smita Agrawal, Sujata Bhatt, Tara Patel, and then Meena Alexander, Monica Verma, Gauri Deshpande, Margaret Chatterjee, Lakshmi Kannan, Shanta Acharya, Sunita Jain, Anna Sujata Mathai, Nirupama Narasimha, Rukmini Baya Nair, Sanjukta Das Gupta, Smita Tiwari, Nandini Sahu, K. Srilata, Rizio Yohannan Raj, Kalpana Singh Chitnis, Sarita Janamani, Sagari Chabria, Rita Malhotra, Ritanath Kesri, Sukrita Paul Kumar, Menka Shivdasani, and there are many. There are many who are doing wonderful work on Indian, they're writing wonderful poetry and talking about the ecology. For most of the Indian women poets, ecology is therapeutic. It's theoretical and therapeutic. It's a mass movement to focus on the idea Vasudeva Kutumbakam. In our Sanskrit version, you have heard Vasudeva Kutumbakam means the entire world is a family. So almost all the women poets that I have been talking about, they have written poetry where they have treated the world as a family. Most of you have been doing your researches on Kamala Das. I don't think that I should be talking a lot about her poetry, but still I will just mention some important poems that she is an ecofeminist poet, and she deals with the common ground between environmentalism and feminism. And then she talks about a strong parallel that exists between male oppression, subordination of women, degradation of nature, and culture over nature. White over black, materialism over spiritualism. So these are her themes. that men over women, culture over nature, and white over black, materialism over spiritualism. Ecofeminism has its main concerns on about these subjects. You know, she talks about social inequality, sexism, other versions of domination of nature, and she talks about a systematic justification of interconnected between men and nature. She has a Nair background and from the Nalapath house, and she talks about the unhappiness as a woman and wife, and she talks about the destructive love and lust that finally brings a change in her poetic vision and living. And also in her poetry, she talks about Lord Krishna, who has changed, and then she changes her religion towards the end, you know, towards the end of her career. She talks about, she converts to Islam. So somebody who was a devotee of Lord Krishna converting towards Islam towards the end of her career creates a lot of controversy in her poetry. In the first person narration, she uniquely talks about a feministic voice against male chauvinism, social disorder. One of her poems, An Introduction, in the collection Summer in Calcutta, it talks about politics and power. The lines are very beautiful. I am Indian, very brown, born in Malabar. I speak three languages, write in two and dream in one. And also some lines from that poem I would quote here. I was a child and later they told me, grow. I became tall, my limbs swelled, and one or two places sprouted hair. I asked for love, not knowing what else to ask for. He drew a youth of 16 into the bedroom and he closed the door. He did not beat me, but my sad woman body felt so beaten. So these kind of lines, you know, they protest about power, position. And after Kamala Das, the next poet I would talk about it is Mamta Kalia. Mamta Kalia is a bilingual poet in English and Hindi. And her important poetry collections are Tribute to Papa and Other Poems and Poems 78. And the poem I would quote, you want me to be like you, Papa, or like Rani Lakshmi Bai. You are not sure what greatness is, but you want me to be great. So such lines where we have a lot of expectations from women. She points out those. And in her poetry, she talks about Shakti and the power vis-a-vis women. And also in her poems, she talks about the Chipku movement in the 1970s. And then the next poet I would talk about, because I don't have much time, so I would like to skip, Sujata Bhatt. She is one poet, very, very important poet. And in her poetry, I find the voice of a girl child. Ecofeminism talks about the girl child and the issues. So she talks about female feticide, the killing of a girl. And in one of her poems, she says, mother, because the girl was killed in her womb before birth. So she says, mother, I am the one you sent away. When the doctor told you I would be a girl, in the end, they had to give me an injection to kill me. But now I ask you to look for me, mother. Look for me because I won't come to your dreams. Look for me, mother. Look because I won't become a flower. I won't turn into a butterfly. And I'm not a part of anyone's song. Look, mother. Look for the place where you have sent me. Look for the unspeakable. And her garlic series of poems, they talk about the ultimate hypocrisy of the society. You know, in the 460 to 370 BC, during that period, the society, the Greek society, and also some parts of Eastern society, including India, they had a garlic test. They never suggested that it might be the man who was infertile. Fertility was very important for a woman, and they thought that only a woman can be infertile. So to test the fertility of a woman, They wrapped a woman in a cloak and they burnt incense beneath her. If the smell could be in her mouth, she was fertile. Similarly, they would keep cloves of garlic and place those in the vagina of a woman in the night. And if next morning her mouth smelled of garlic, then she could conceive and she was a fertile woman. If her mouth did not smell of garlic, then she would be, you know, an infertile woman. And Sujata Bhatt, she raised her voice against these kind of injustice to women. And she writes, as the woman who was a victim of the garlic test, she writes, "I cannot breathe." And then he comes with his clove of garlic, with his hot garlicky breath, and his beard sharper than thorns, and his face of stone. "I cannot breathe." But he opens my mouth, and then I must keep this clove of garlic inside, where my flesh has become so raw that it burns. It hasn't rained for months, and I lie facing the window and watch the crows pick the stolen seeds. Rain is the allegory for the monthly cycle of the female person, and then she cannot breathe. And every month she bleeds, means she is not able to conceive. She is infertile. Apparently she is infertile. So this garlic test continues. She writes, "I cannot breathe." And every morning he comes full of remorse with his hot garlicky breath. He opens my mouth, and then I must remove this clove of garlic from this burning flesh. And I think that if I would bleed, at least the blood would heal me. So she wants to bleed. She doesn't want to become pregnant, you see. She writes, "I would bleed. At least the blood would heal me. At least the blood would soothe the garlic scrubbed cuts." So through such acts of protesting for women, universalizing the pain lot of women had to undergo throughout the world, in Greece and in India, in so many parts of the world, Sujata Bhatt has written such pragmatic poetry, ecofeministic poetry, associating the oppressed and the oppressor, and talking about the emancipation of the people through her persony, and her protest literature has become a part of ecofeministic literature. And then I come to the next generation, the new generation of English poets that I represent. In my poetry, I accept nature, natural landscape, myth and history together. My poetry is closely associated with ecology. As I already told you in the beginning, that the other voice, the silence, silver poems on my lips, and Sukama and other poems. All four collections, they have ecological concern. In the poetry collection Sukama and other poems, there is a tribal woman, Sukama, and the injustices given to her, done to her, have been pointed out in that poetry collection. The tattoos on her face, the horizontal and the vertical tattoos her husband itched on her face to make her ugly, was the subject of the poem. Sukama accepted that happily. She thought that it's the duty of her husband to make her ugly by creating those tattoos on her face, horizontal and vertical tattoos. If you Google the tattoo faces of Kondh tribal women in Orissa, you will see what kind of tattoos are made on their face. So I am trying to problematize that in that poetry collection. The Sukama kind of women, they make us, the powerful, the empowered women, and then they go to oblivion. We tend to forget them. So that poetry collection is my dedication to Sukama, where I have tried to talk about all those tribal, subaltern folk women, and that is a part of my folk literature. And then the next two poetry collections are Sita and Zero Point. In Sita, I have pointed out the progressive, independent, contemporary, modern Sita, who has accepted life as it is. She has no complaints. She is not brooding or crying or complaining over the injustice done to her by leaving her in the forest during pregnancy. Rather, my Sita is a person, an ecofeminist, who is close to nature. As a single parent, she has given birth to her children, Love and Kush, and she has given them appropriate education, very good education, through which, you know, Love and Kush could win over the world. And then she is a healer. She is a very good cook, and she is a touch therapist. She will. She has the healing touch, and she touches the wounded deers in the forest, and she heals them. So that kind of a progressive, independent, contemporary, modern, and optimistic woman is my Sita, where there are 25 cantos and one complete book. If you can Google Sita by Nandini Sahu, you will get to know a lot about it. So, you know, in my poetry, I talk about the natural, familial, and the mythological reconstructions. Myth and folklore always supply me the background. The mythological reconstruction, like Sita is my character, and I have written poems about Draupadi, about Karna, and all mythological characters, and then I have deconstructed them. I have placed them vis-a-vis us contemporary men and women. I have not talked only about women, as I told you. I have very powerful, very important male characters, and also the third gender characters, the characters from the third sex, the third gender. So I try to take all of them in a natural and familial environment. One of my poems, Puri Beach, it talks about the high sensitiveness of the temple of Lord Jagannath. And then some of the lines of the poem, here history creates chapters new. Lord Jagannath smiles all the while with wide open eyes. Here the sea and the sand invite. The sunbeams descend like daydreams, reaping the spaced out canvas of the sky, life breathes. And I have one poem, An Evening at Konark, where I'm trying to talk about Dharma, the 12 years old boy who saves the life of 1200 artisans who were engaged in the construction of the sun temple of Konark. And then he gives a complete formation to the crowning slab of that world famous sun temple of Konark. But then there is the possibility that the king will punish all the 1200 artisans next morning because they could not do what Dharma could do. So ultimately, the little boy Dharma, he jumps into the ocean, and then he saves the life of the 1200 artisans. So I talk about Dharma in my poetry. So, you know, I try to take such characters from mythology, history, and daily life where people are, you know, given some sort of injustice, and I try to protest for them through my literature. In one of my most recent poems, I would close with this poem. The title of the poem is Letter to My Unborn Daughter. 19 years back, exactly 19 years back, I lost my unborn daughter to some sort of violence. And after 19 years, I could gather the courage and the conviction to write a letter to my unborn daughter. It's a poem that is close to my heart. It's a heart-rending poem. I would close my lecture with this, reciting this poem, where I'm talking about the protection of the girl child. As I told you, that ecofeminism talks about so many issues like senior citizens, preservation, livestock, environment, ecology, pollution, education for all, and protection of the girl child. So this is one of my most important ecofeministic poems. The title of the poem is Letter to My Unborn Daughter. Tiny limbs smeared with my fresh inflamed blood, oozing out of the womb, gushing in fact, I knew I had lost you. Then and there, shattered. The shadow masochist burped then and snored. In a short while, when the maid rushed us to the local hospital, I heard what you never uttered. Ah, healers, protectors, you and me and you, mom and her little girlie, wish to take the world in their stride. Today, a letter to you, my unborn daughter, after long 2 decades of quiet travail, telling our tales to your younger brother with a bleeding heart, I smile with exuding tears. Smile to see my dream daughter alive in her little brother, so full of love and compassion. So much a feminist, humanist male, so strong to hold mom's head high, so much you, so as I would have you. Ah, there was such rage over a female fetus growing up to be a girl of power and conviction like Mom Dear or like the Pancha Mahakanya and the marital rapes that threats to snatch you any given day. My descent and then the termination. If at all there is a next birth for you, my little fairy, come back to my womb. Life minus you is such dreary. You need not play the games that the heart must play. Pronounce before birth, you are gonna be the woman of clay. And then I'm comparing the unborn child to so many characters of mythology. And then the last few lines, sir. Forgive me, my love, for you died with the petals falling from my autumny breast, the breast that you never suckled. You rain on my being and burn my heart, but calm my soul. You will stay indomitable, taking new lives every single day in mom's prayers, poetry, social responsibilities, ecofeminism, messages, voice, layers of thoughts and action. My girl, I am what I decided to be after losing you. That is the euphemism. I'm not just a woman since that fateful night, but entire womankind. Now I am a woman of full circle. Within me, there is the power to create, nurture, and transform. I rediscover pieces of myself through your unborn narrative in the resonance of my quirky confluence. So this is the poem. And to conclude, I would say that ecofeminism continues to be a work of progress in Indian poetry. We all are still working on ecofeminism. Third world feminism, it challenges dualistic hierarchies, binary oppositions, social positions of the powerful genders. Ecofeminism, it problematizes westernization and it reaches for ancient wisdom. It welcomes folklore. God takes birth where women are worshipped. That is what is written in our Vedas. It means that nature constituted by the five elements that controls the planet and the whole universe is actually respectful of all the three genders. Both women and nature, like Maya and Mahamaya, both of them are tolerant. Nature and women, Maya and Mahamaya, they are tolerant, but it is up to a particular limit. Beyond the limit of tolerance, both women are both ecology, both women and ecology, they become uncontrollable and hazardous. That is what ecofeminism talks about. COVID-19 is the best example of that, that we tried to exploit planet Earth, and this is the scenario that we are facing today. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, am I audible to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, okay. Thank you, ma'am. It was a wonderful presentation on time-befitting subject. And you have explained well on the injustice faced by women in the society. And a personal compliment from my side. We are fortunate to hear the beauty of the poem through your voice. Thank you so much, ma'am.